Welcome and thank you for joining. Looks like we have folks from all over the country and the Caribbean here with us. This webinar series is brought to you by the National Hurricane Center and NOAA's Southeast and Caribbean Regional Collaboration Team, which is one of 8 regional collaboration teams in the country. This webinar will be recorded and will be posted later at a website I'm going to link to you on the question box here. As a courtesy to our presenter, all attendees are muted. If you have a question, please type it in the question box. And due to the high volume of attendees, some slides might be delayed. So my name is Shirley Merlo. I am the Deputy Director of NOAA's Hurricane Research Division, which is located at the Atlantic Meteorological Laboratory in Miami, Florida. I'm joined by my colleague here, Dan Brown, who is with the National Hurricane Center. He's a Warning Coordinator Meteorologist for the National Hurricane Center. Let me just share one more thing here with you, present. So as I mentioned, this is one of a series of webinars. And so this is our webpage where you can find all of the webinars. I'll put the link to this website on the chat box so that you can register for additional seminars that we will be having throughout Monday at the same time, same bat channel, same time. So welcome to come join us next time. For our next couple of seminars. So now I'm going to introduce the speakers that we have today. We have Ken Graham. He's the director of the National Hurricane Center. He's going to be sharing with us, as well as Roger Erickson and Tim Callaghan. Roger Erickson is with the National Weather Service out in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and Tim Callaghan, he's with USAID. So they're going to talk about, last year we had a record season. So they're going to talk about the national perspective, the local perspective for Lake Charles, and then talking about the recovery efforts. So hang on as we transfer the presenter here, and we are off to go. So thank you again. Ken, should be good.
All right, should be sharing a part of my screen, hopefully.
We see it, so go ahead and make it.
Shirley, does it look okay?
Yes, it looks okay, good, thank you.
Oh, perfect, so yeah, hello everybody. I appreciate everybody dialing in today, and what a season it was. You'll hear, you know, from Roger some of the local impacts that we had this year, which were, you know, quite a few, basically. I'm gonna rearrange some of the video on my screen so I can see, and we should be in pretty good shape. So let me cover some of the season and look at some new things coming up for 21, but what a season it was. You know, you start looking at all the records that we had last year, and let's see, trying to advance it, Shirley, there we go. Just a few records. I literally could have come up with 2 or 3 pages of records. There were so many from last season. But here's just a few. I mean, take this in from a perspective from the Hurricane Center, looking at, you know, the Atlantic, looking at how busy things were. 6 straight year with at least one named storm prior to the official start of the Atlantic season. We had the most named storms in 170 years of record keeping, 30 named storms. Had the most U.S. landfalls with 11. That surpasses 9 back in 1916. Only the second time on record of having 5 or more tropical cyclones at the same time. One of the highest surge events for Louisiana, and you'll hear some of those impacts from Roger down on the ground. Yeah, really close, 17.1 up to 18 feet of storm surge, just a staggering amount of storm surge. Third most hours flown by the hurricane hunters of the Air Force. Only 1985 and 2005 were higher. NOAA Aircraft Operations Center, that's the NOAA Hurricane Hunters, highest ever amount of hours, over 110% higher than average, their benchmark in 2005. Just incredible. Here at the Hurricane Center, we had 639 advisory packages in the Atlantic only for the season. I mean, average is 322. So that's just staggering. First time we had 2 major hurricanes in November, and the first Greek alphabet name to reach a Category 5. So just absolutely staggering, some of the records. That's what it looks like, just if you start drawing the tracks. One thing to notice is that the Gulf of Mexico, there's not too many spaces there not covered by at least some sort of impact from tropical systems. Just staggering how active the Gulf of Mexico was. And here's another way to look at it, just capturing the great NOAA satellite imagery that we have across the board at some of these storms. They all look a little different. We always talk about they're all different, and they sure are different in their structure, their impacts, and of course their size. I do want to give a big shout out here. What a team effort all across NOAA, from the satellites to the buoys to the data on the coast, the measurements that we have. You just look across the board at the entire effort, and it's not just the coast. We talk about that quite a bit. You can see how far inland some of the data goes, the yellow being the tropical storm warnings. Look how far some of the hurricane warnings stretch up into all the way up to the Arkansas border and in Louisiana, and also all, you know, into East Texas, especially their Southeast Texas. So 378 hours, take that in, 15.75 days of hurricane warnings, just absolutely staggering. Coastal watches and warnings in effect for Louisiana, 474 hours. And if that's taking in the warnings and the watches, and 14 of those systems require the issuance of watches and warnings on the first advisory. And that's always difficult because that means it's strengthening close to the coast. It's just forming. The genesis phase is close to the coast, and that never gives a whole lot of time to work the timelines on that one. I did want to cover this. So yeah, busy season, but take it in with a pandemic at the same time. So we really, you know, Dan's on the call here today, and let's see, Robbie was involved, and John, the whole team got together and created Hurricanes at Home, and it's when the schools first started, you know, getting out of the classroom and getting into the home. Teachers needed help with some of the material and trying to get people prepared for the hurricane season. So both English and Spanish, we conducted just enough of these to reach thousands of school kids to be able to talk about safety, talk about going into this hurricane season in a pandemic. So I think that really helped. But in addition to the outreach, we took big precautions here at the office. We moved workstations around. We had cohort scheduling to keep people away from each other. We reduced the numbers in the building as much as we can with some home telework. Had a full safety plan that we worked on, distancing, masks, you name it. We did everything we could to stay safe. Virtual shift changes, somebody on a phone in the parking lot where they wouldn't be able to have that interaction. We did those type of things. And the left picture is interesting. You know, you look at that blue tape, and when the hurricane specialist was inside that tape, nobody else was allowed inside that area there. So we did everything we could. And the reality was, you know, we just couldn't lose the center with such a busy season. There's no way we could lose this place, because if we stay safe, we can keep the public safe. And that was the whole mantra the entire time. Here's a few thoughts and I'll wrap up. These are some thoughts from the season. Words matter. Roger will attest to that and talk about some of this. I mean, when you look at the red area there, kind of a pink color, storm surge warnings, it's one thing to say 15 to 20 feet above ground. And I'm talking about Laura in this situation, Hurricane Laura. It's another thing to have a storm surge warning and talk about how dangerous this is. And you can have all sorts of maps. But when you start talking 15 to 20 feet and you still have people in that area, it's just flat scary. And we don't use words like this very often. It's very rare that we'll use words like this, but we did use the word unsurvivable. And as far as I know, everybody got out, and we did not have any storm surge fatalities in Hurricane Laura, despite the record amount of storm surge. So words do matter. And I think that's something to think about. You can have a perfect forecast. If it's not actionable and understood, there's still a breakdown there. So it's real important. The indirect fatalities is another one. You're not out of danger after the storm. Health issues historically have been some of the big ones. But I know after Hurricane Laura, we had a significant number of fatalities related to generators. So we need to think about some of the messaging that we have, you know, afterwards, just make sure we continue with that before, during, and after, message the dangers of some of these indirect fatalities. And it's interesting to note with the population that's the most vulnerable, 8 times as many victims over the age 60 as under 21. So it's so important to keep communicating, take care of our family, take care of our parents and grandparents. Just some of the messaging can make a big difference. I won't go through this because there's not a lot of time for each of us, but I will say this. You can see some of the statistics, the fatality statistics above, but here's interesting. Historically, storm surge is a leading cause of fatalities in tropical systems. However, in the last 4 years, think about this. We've had, since 2017, 14 hurricane landfalls, 5 were major hurricanes, and we've had 7 storm surge fatalities. So in the last 4 years, we've lost more people to carbon monoxide poisoning after the storm than we have storm surge. So it's just really drives home the multi-hazard nature of what we do. Number 3, and I'll wrap up. There's only about 6 of these. Hurricane little wiggles matter. I use that a lot. This to me is very powerful, and why we do forecasting the way we do it in a probabilistic sense. The purple line there is Hurricane Laura's track. The dotted blue line there is if we happen to move Laura 20 miles to the west. And the colors on the ground there is basically the change in the storm surge. So if you think about areas of coastal Louisiana 10 to 15 feet higher, if we just move the storm 20 miles, look closer to where Roger is up there in Lake Charles. There's some areas there 3 to 5 feet, even up to 5 to 10 feet higher. The bottom line is 2 days ahead of time. I don't know either side of that line, 10, 15, 20 miles, where that storm's going to go. So you have to do it in a probabilistic sense. The goal here is to get people out of harm's way. Those little wiggles, they really make a difference. And this is a good way to be able to see it. Every storm's so different. The initial intensity, it's interesting if the storm increases. So if the storm gets stronger, the average error here from the Hurricane Center gets smaller. So we do better with the stronger storms. We get better with those. During the genesis phase, when they first start, if they're like a Sally situation where the center's reforming and bouncing around, the verification's tougher. If you move the center 20 miles, the end result a couple of days later could be 40 or 50 miles different. So just remember that every storm is different, even from a forecast perspective, they could be very different. And you look at Laura, you look at Marco, you look at Sally, look how different those are in terms of the actual track forecast. You plop all of the track forecasts on there. What a big difference. Please remember this. This is so important. Hurricanes don't care about your timelines. You may have 10 to 15 days. You may have 3 to 4 days notice. So please, when you're doing exercises, you know, whether you're home planning or work planning, whatever you do, just make sure you're ready to accelerate those timelines. And look, 9 tropical cyclones in 2020 underwent rapid intensification. So rapidly intensifying, a whole bunch of these were pretty close to landfall. So that can change really quick during the situation. And be careful picking your favorite model. You look at the guidance. This is the guidance for Hurricane Laura. This was 1800 Z, August 24th. Watch what happens. I mean, you look at that at the Hurricane Center. We're like, all right, Lake Charles, you're the ones. I mean, that pretty much puts a bullseye in southwest Louisiana, but the guidance starts to shift. 0Z, August 25th, a little bit shift to the west, and look what happens by 06Z on the 25th. All that guidance starts shifting. Just remember, any individual model is one thing, but we're looking at dozens and dozens, 50 to 60 ensembles of these models. The white line on the right is the actual Hurricane Laura forecast, despite where those models were going. So the takeaway here is the official NAC forecast beats those models every time. So be very careful just picking one of those, because you can look at the consequences of getting some of those westward tracks. I mean, that's a lot of storm surge in Texas if those tracks would have been correct. So that's why it gets really pretty dicey with time. And you can see the consistency here with where Laura is versus where the models were. That's a big difference, folks. So be careful using those individual ones. Why does it matter? Here's why it matters. We got to get better with the accuracy of the forecast. On the left, 1999, Hurricane Floyd, biggest evacuation in U.S. history, 2.6 million people. But on the right was Dorian, and as many as 3 million people did not evacuate. So it makes a big difference, and that's why we work so hard to continuously get better. So a couple new things this year. Here's soon. I'm looking at the May 3rd, May 15th. We'll start issuing the outlooks for the Atlantic and the Pacific, the outlook for the system. So you're going to start seeing that on the website. So we're doing it earlier in the Atlantic because 6 straight years with a storm that's early. You're going to see that. We're not using the Greek alphabet any longer associated with the overflow list. So that's new. And we got a big upgrade to the storm surge model, everybody. And it's going to help us with the storm surge forecast because it's going to help us get a better structure of the actual storm itself. So I think that's a really exciting thing to come. So we're really looking forward to that in the near future. In fact, it's going to be this current season. So that's it. I tried to be sensitive to the time. I probably went faster than I normally would, Shirley, but I wanted to make sure everybody had plenty of time. So that's all I got.
Oh, thank you. That was a great wrap up, a great, just a quick blur of looking at how you guys dealt with the season. It was a record-breaking season, like you said, in the pandemic. Boy, you guys did a Herculean effort, and it shows. I mean, I heard that you were nominated for a SAMMY, so good luck to you, Ken. Get those votes out there. For any of those who knows about what SAMMYs are, it talks about federal employees who've done amazing work during this past year or so. So good luck to you, Ken. So let's see, we got a quick question before we transition to Roger. There is one question here, and then we're going to go back and at the very end we'll answer more questions. So Dan, would you like to take one of the questions and address it to Ken?
Sure, Ken. I did see one question that came in about if we're not using the Greek alphabet this year, how would we name those storms if we run out of names on our list from year to year? I'll let you answer that one, Ken.
Yeah, you know, just a teeny bit of history with that, with the Greek alphabet. You know, we've only had to do that twice, right? 2005 and 2020. But there were issues with translating into Spanish and Portuguese and French. Remember, we cover all the countries. 28 nations are a member of the World Meteorological Organization Region 4. So we all have to translate these things. But there was Zeta, Eta, Theta. There were a lot of people that when we had Zeta, they thought that was the last in the alphabet because it started with Z. It really distracted from actually the messaging that we want with the hurricane. So we made a decision and a proposal. It was passed by the World Meteorological Organization, and we have an overflow list of regular names, you know, the regular English and Spanish names. And, you know, we repeat the names. We go through every 6 years, we'll use the list, and then it repeats. So this list will be continuous through that 6 years and keep on going. So it'll be a familiar thing. When we run out of names, we'll start with A again, but at least it'll be able to pronounce it, translate it, and I think it's a better service so we can concentrate on those impacts, Dan.
Thanks, Ken. I'll throw you just one more that someone asked, do we envision any records being broken for 2021? I sure hope not. I hope, or at least the records for a quiet year, but we'll see. We don't have the seasonal forecast yet, right, Ken?
I am. The official forecast on May 20th. I tell you, I'd like to set a record with no landfalls. I'd like to set a record with the fewest storms and least impact. So many people were impacted, not just the United States. You know, you think about four landfalls in Louisiana alone, but our friends in Central America got hit so hard. And, you know, so it's just a dangerous situation. And now we have a volcano that we're dealing with that you've seen in the Caribbean. So anyway, I hope no records. And if we do, I hope it's on the opposite end as last year.
Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Dan. So let's move along and let's introduce Roger Erickson. And just to note that Roger is not foreseeing the future by his slide saying active 2021. Hopefully that's just a little typo. Yeah, that's just a good typo. We're not saying that this year is going to be active. It's just a little typo. So go ahead, Roger. Tell us your experience.
Sure thing. You know, starting off the National Weather Service, we have 122 weather offices all across the country. And Lake Charles, I put a little circle around it. We're on the Texas-Louisiana state line. And we cover 16 parishes, six counties in Texas. Last year, we had seven tropical systems within 300 miles of us. If you go to this NOAA website, the coast.noaa.gov/hurricanes, you can look at historical data for your local area. And so I put a point near our coast and plotted all the systems that were within 300 miles of us from last year. Started early in the year with Cristobal that was coming towards southeast Louisiana. We jumped to Hannah, which hit Texas. And then we went crazy with Marco and Laura back to back heading towards Louisiana before we switched to Beta back in Texas, Delta and Zeta again in Louisiana. Starting off with the combo package of Marco and Laura, you know, probably one of the more difficult things from a local perspective, and I'm sure as on a national level as well, is when you have two tropical systems coming into the same area along the Gulf Coast or an East Coast event, it makes sometimes a message very confusing. Are we talking about Marco or are we talking about Laura? I didn't want to display two different systems on the same graphic like this slide here, but I had too many of my emergency managers that wanted to see them overlaid on top of each other. So I did this graphic here, but I also did individual slides to talk about what was going on from one to the other. Kind of early on, before Laura came and makes landfall in our area as a category four, a lot of focus was on Marco. Marco's the graphic here on the left that was at one point advertised to become a hurricane heading towards the Texas-Louisiana state line. So big impact potentially for the Houston-Galveston area, the Beaumont-Port Arthur area of Texas, which is a big refinery area for the United States. So a big economic impact potentially on the United States if Marco had verified and had potentially intensified. So we had that going on. A lot of focus on Marco. Laura started out being forecast to be an Eastern Gulf event, but as time went on, the scenario for Laura shifted further west, coming towards Louisiana. Marco shifted a little bit further west as well, but still the right front quadrant where the most active weather occurs in typical tropical systems was still going to be Southeast Texas. So we're still messaging out two different systems potentially impacting the same areas. Well, finally, Marco keeps going north and the forecast track kind of changed significantly. So by Sunday, August 23rd, Marco was forecasted to go into Southeast Louisiana potentially as a hurricane. Meanwhile, Laura's going to come into Louisiana potentially as a category three or stronger sometime by Wednesday. So this is a forecast on Sunday, and we're messaging something that's going to be occurring potentially in the next 24 to 72 hours across our area. And the problem was some people focused on Marco too long. Even when the Hurricane Center lowered all the products and advisories and watches, warnings for the coastal sections of Louisiana, people were still focused on, well, what about Marco? Could it regenerate? Could it be a problem here? And so people were really hung up on Marco because of the fact that it was potentially going to be a big system 3 or 4 days earlier than that. So, I don't have the answers and what we can do for that, but it's a situation where people will get stuck on one system and then we're trying to steer them back to the one that's actually going to be the big story for us, the major hurricane Laura coming in. And, you know, the problem with us locally here in Lake Charles National Weather Service Office was we were actually in an inundation zone potentially from Laura. This is a graphic that the Hurricane Center put together showcasing the different levels of water depths potential across Southwest Louisiana. And the Lake Charles office is indicated by that white star on there. We're between the orange and red zones. So we're looking at 6 feet or greater above ground level for water level depths by our office. So guess what? We have to evacuate. We're not going to stay in an office that's going to potentially have 6 feet or more storm surge water in it. So we actually called for an evacuation. The neat thing with our evacuation call was this. The local officials were having a really hard time convincing people to leave with Laura coming in. I don't know if it was because of the COVID-19 situation where people didn't want to leave because of that, but we were not getting a very good number of people evacuating, leading up to a category three or stronger hurricane coming into the area. Once everyone saw that we were evacuating, they evacuated. So it's a funny story associated with Laura was the fact that when we evacuated, everyone and their mother evacuated Southwest Louisiana. So great story for that perspective that everyone followed our lead and got out of the area. Now, the dirty little secret is not everyone in the office evacuated. Me and my boss, Andy Patrick, we actually stayed at the local emergency operations center in downtown Lake Charles. And this is their 11-story, 12-story building in downtown Lake Charles where we were located with them. Typically in this building on the second floor, there's a large room where they do weather briefings, where we do the weather briefings, and then they kind of have a powwow in terms of what the parish, what Southwest Louisiana is going to do. This is a typical picture here showing over 50 people in the room, small confined areas. They couldn't do that last year because of COVID-19. So it was a ghost town in the EOC as a category four hurricane is heading towards them. So what did they do? We all went into individual offices on the second floor, the third floor, the fourth floor. So me and Andy were in a small office, wearing our masks, had our laptops going, and we were monitoring the weather from the Hurricane Center, what was going on locally, providing support to not only the local officials, but also state and federal agencies that were embedded within us as well. We had, of course, the state police in the building there with us. We had FEMA was actually in the building with us. They were two doors down. So we were providing briefings to the FEMA people that were going to be the first ones on the street to help the local areas related to that perspective. So, you know, in terms of briefing data, we have satellite data that giving updates from the Hurricane Center. We've got the local weather radar. We're showing the eye of the hurricane as it's coming in. We've got a lot of weather observations all across the area, showing us the wind direction and the wind gusts occurring, and a lot of NOS tide gauges as well at the coast. So we got a lot of data that we're pushing out to people saying, this is what we got so far, and this is what we're expect coming in later on tonight. The problem is sometimes with tropical systems is some of the data disappears. Now the satellite data, we did not have any problems with at all. That stayed up all the way through the event. But the big problem for us was the local weather radar. The Lake Charles radar at our office was pretty much destroyed from the winds of the hurricane. And so we were using the radar data from Slidell office in Southeast Louisiana and Houston, Texas area for Southwest Louisiana and Southeast Texas. So these are actually two different depictions of the same storm at the same time. The one on the left shows the eye over DeRidder. You can see the western eye wall associated with Laura as it was inland. This, at this point, was still 120 mile wind speeds associated with it up in DeRidder. And then the graphic on the right was showing some of the outer rain bands moving on shore from Morgan City up towards Lafayette, where we had potentially tornado situations going on in those outer rain bands. The weather observations start dropping out near the center of circulation where the strongest winds occurred. Here at the office, we did lose our local ASAW station. All the equipment was decimated by the wind, probably debris flying through the air, hit it and destroyed it. The good news is that we did have most of our, well, all of our NOS tide gauges continued running, and many of our inland stations as well kept going on throughout the event for us. Now, these are actually videos which probably won't work here, so I'm going to skip over the video perspective, but I'm going to just quickly tell you that the one on the left is actually a video of me taking a picture or taking a video of the window in the office that me and Andy are in. While I'm doing these briefings, I'm hearing a chair creaking behind me, and I thought Andy was getting nervous, rocking his chair, and I was like, hey, you okay back there? And he's like, yeah, why? And I was like, well, I'm hearing this creaking sound, and he's like, well, that's not me. I was like, well, what is it? And, you know, we start looking around the room, and it turns out the window itself was breathing. It was creaking, you know, starts off like every 30 seconds. And then as the night progressed, it became every 15 seconds, every 10 seconds, every 5 seconds. And then it, at some point, it's just continually making a sound. So we were in this room. We were on the west side of the building, by the way. So this wasn't the side we were expecting debris to impact it and to you know, come into the room or anything like that, but we knew that there was potential for this window to actually be pulled out because of the pressure outside the window there. Fortunately, it did not go out. The video in the middle was actually an exterior wind door on the first floor that showed some of the water coming in around the edge of the door, because even if you have a sealed door, it doesn't matter when the wind is blowing at 130 miles an hour plus outside, it's going to be finding ways to push that rainfall into the building there with you. And the graphic on the right was a you know, very well-enforced window that I was peeking out of. We had a lot of storm chasers in the area, and they were out there videoing what was actually going on. And you can probably go to YouTube and see a lot of people's videos of the craziness of what it was like in downtown Lake Charles as we were going through the event. Now, back at the office, this is the view from the top of our radar dome. Normally there's a big dome over the top of this thing, and you can see it's all smashed up. So we actually had to have other offices keep track of the weather for us for several weeks. Besides losing the weather radar, we lost our upper air building. The doors are blown off of it in the middle picture there. The other middle picture is our equipment where we receive data into our AWIP system in the office. It took us over a month before that was replaced as well. So we had a lot of data issues just getting information into the office. And so we had backup offices that were taking care of us. Here's the shot of before and after the hurricane, showing what the radar looked like, before and after. The great story here with this was in the middle of a recovery period here in Southwest Louisiana, the ROC, the NOAA ROC office in Oklahoma, was able to bring down a crew down here. They're able to get a big crane, because you're going to need a big, tall crane to get that broken radar equipment off the top of the tower there. They were able to come in here, remove it rather quickly, and all things considered, and put a new one up there within 5 months. So we went offline at the end of August. We were back online by the end of January of earlier this year. So great kudos to other parts of NOAA that work with us as well. And also a big thank you for other National Weather Service forecast offices across the area, Brownsville, Houston, New Orleans, all provided our watch warning advisories, as well as our forecast grids for weeks at a time after the fact. Our TAFs forecast for the airports was done by the weather office in Tampa. And we had a lot of assistance after the fact doing storm surveys from our partners to the north in Shreveport. They came down and covered our northern area to see the wind effects for our inland areas. And then we had partners over in Houston that came over and helped us out with the storm surge surveying to our south. So when it was all said and done, this is what we had. 3 people in my forecast area died from the wind. We had 0 died in the storm surge perspective, but we had unfortunately 14 from carbon monoxide, and then another 7 from heat and another 7 from accident. And Ken had mentioned earlier that, you know, we're having a lot of fatalities after the fact, after the storms passed through. And that happened here locally in the Lake Charles forecast area, where we had 28 fatalities associated with things that were not at all related to the wind blowing or the water rising. This is just simply after effects. The big one there, the 14, unfortunately, for carbon monoxide from having improper generator usage, and then just all the other things that can happen after a hurricane. This is where the storm surge ended up going, a little bit east of Lake Charles. And so we were fortunate the office did not flood associated with it. And these are the wind speeds that were associated with it as well. You know, we had incredible wind speeds, gusts over 135 to 140 in downtown Lake Charles. So just incredible wind speeds that we had inland. And you go even points further inland and DeRidder, which is 75 miles inland, wind speeds were up of 130 miles an hour. And even in Leesville, that point number 4, 95 miles inland, still had wind gusts in the range of 115 to 120 mile hour winds. Unfortunately, we had to do it again 43 days later with Delta. We were working in the office without the radar. This is what happened with the storm surge perspective, and this is what happened with the winds. The good news is we also had partnerships again with other parts of NOAA, where they brought a portable Doppler radar down from Norman, Oklahoma, that was able to help us out locally, watching the eye of the hurricane as Delta made landfall, because Delta made landfall probably within 30 miles of where Laura had made landfall 43 days earlier. So very similar areas got impacted by it. Unfortunately, there was a lot of rain associated with Delta. And why that's a story is because all of us had tarps on our roofs. We hadn't had the roofs repaired yet. And so the wind came along and Delta tore off the tarps, and we got even more damage inside of our houses. This is a picture of my house when it was all said and done. Part of the roof came off. That exterior wall is very fragile, or it could fall down. Here we are May 3rd, and I still haven't gotten paid by my insurance company. I did replace the roof, and that's all I've been able to do so far with my own money, still waiting on my insurance company to pay out the rest of it. And I'm just one story of thousands here in Southwest Louisiana waiting to fix our houses. And here we are going into the next hurricane season, and our houses aren't even repaired down here. So it's a pretty big story going on over here, the vulnerability of Southwest Louisiana as we're approaching this upcoming hurricane season. And that's all I've got for you guys today. Thank you.
Wow. I'm speechless, Roger. I can't believe you had all that damage. And I tell you, we're getting a lot of questions here on the chat. I'm going to quickly go through one. You guys did one heck of a job, Elizabeth says here. What you did was amazing with having to deal with all the systems back to back. You know, there she's saying, thank you for your service. Let's see if we have one more question before we go to Tim. Dan, is there any question that you see that?
I did see a question, Shirley, that was interesting, because I know it was certainly an issue for us at NHC about messaging both Marco and Laura threatening the Gulf at the same time. So, Roger, when you mentioned that people were focused on Marco for too long, did you mean the residents themselves, or did you mean some of the regional emergency manager in the area?
To clarify, I'm talking about the public. The general public was focused on it. Yeah, the local emergency managers, regional emergency managers, they compartmentalized it. They moved on when they needed to Laura. But the public, that's I think part of the reason why the public was so slow to respond to evacuation orders across Southeast Texas and Southwest Louisiana because they're still kind of confused about, well, what about Marco?
Yeah, and there was also a couple of comments about the generators and just, you know, clarification that that was a big problem. I know during last hurricane season, there were at least 19 carbon monoxide generator related fatalities in the U.S. You mentioned the ones here during Laura. I know there were some during Hannah that struck South Texas as well. And we saw that this past winter in Texas in the Central Plains after the cold Arctic outbreak as well. So it's just something I know that we're trying to message. I'm sure you're trying to message any comments on that. I know that your office did put out some messaging immediately after the storm. So maybe you can talk about that.
Yeah, it was very important. You know, when we right after the storm, Brownsville, the National Weather Service office in Brownsville, Texas, was actually putting out all of our products, and they were doing a lot of our social media work as well. So we coordinated that call very closely in terms of the carbon monoxide dangers associated with what happens after a hurricane. And so that was going out. And then even from the heat perspective, we knew that we're going to have people without power for a long time, working outdoors, getting hot. And so we actually lowered the criteria for our heat advisories temporarily during that window where the power outages were very high across Southwest Louisiana, going into Central Louisiana, even parts of Northern Louisiana, a collaborative effort between multiple National Air Service offices to lower the criteria just to get the messaging out about the heat issues also.
Thanks, Roger. One final one I'll throw to you. It's talking about, is there any talk about moving the office away from that storm surge evacuation area? Probably not, but I'm sure it makes it your jobs more difficult that you are in that evacuation zone.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. You know, Ken had that graphic that showed just a 20-mile shift of the forecast track probably saved our office from flooding. Back in 2005 with Rita, the water was halfway across the airport coming to our office. And in 2008 with Hurricane Ike, same thing. We had water probably within 200 yards of the office, both in Rita in 2005 and Ike in 2008. So we're in a vulnerable location. Higher ups are aware of it. And, you know, hopefully someday we'll be able to find a place where we can move, you know, in a safer location away from the storm surge zone.
Yeah, thank you, Roger. So we'll come back to you, as well as we'll come back to Ken with additional questions at the end. So now we're going to shift to talk to Tim Callaghan. He is with the USAID. He's going to be joining us via phone. So Tim, take it away, and I'm going to switch the slide. Just one slide. Great. While you hear his voice.
Yeah, good afternoon. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, my name is Tim Callaghan. I work for USAID. The Bureau for Humanitarian Assistance, or BHA. Some of you may know it as what we call Legacy OFDA, the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance. I'm based in Costa Rica, so I'm going to shift a little bit. My focus, obviously, because my mandate's a little different, I'm going to focus more overseas and what AID does overseas. So, you know, we're the lead federal agency to coordinate the U.S. government's response to disasters and complex emergencies worldwide. Obviously, you know, one thing, and listening to the discussion this morning, from my standpoint, I've been here in Costa Rica. It'll be 20 years in October, 18 years as a senior advisor. So I've lived through a lot of hurricanes over the years. One thing for us that's kind of our motto is, you know, we prepare the same. If the forecast is for 18 storms or six storms, because we all know that the phrase, all it takes is one to cause damage and destruction. The other thing, obviously, for me, you know, we focus a lot of times on the word hurricane, but in the region, especially places like Haiti, I've seen death and destruction by just tropical storms, a lot of rain. Our mandate is to save lives and alleviate suffering, very simple. You know, we are our counterparts in a country. Is the FEMA equivalent, or what we call the National Disaster Organizations, or the so last year, for example, with the devastation caused in Central America, you know, we focused, we worked in Nicaragua, we worked in Colombia, but our main focus was in Honduras and Guatemala. So we coordinate our effort, our response effort, with COPECO in Honduras and CONRED in Guatemala. you know, we also, anybody below, you know, within the national system, we're obviously working closely with Red Cross. You know, from our standpoint, how we work is when a country makes a request, it really is kind of simple. You know, whatever's happened, the disaster, the emergency, when it's beyond the ability of the affected country to respond, then a country will make a request or write a statement to the U.S. ambassador in a particular country requesting assistance. With that, our chief of mission has authority immediately for up to $100,000. But in the devastation last year, again, our response in the four countries was $53 million. You know, we work in different sectors like water, sanitation, hygiene, food assistance, of course, was a big response part of our effort. You know, we have a warehouse in Miami, Florida. We also have a warehouse of food commodities in Houston, Texas. In this situation, USAID in Washington deployed what's called the Disaster Assistance Response Team, or a DART. I was the DART team leader. We have in Washington that supports us with the interagency called the Response Management Team. Most of our funding goes, you know, we don't give resources directly to governments. We fund through established non-government organizations, whether it's World Vision, Catholic Relief Services, ADRA, and or the United Nations. You know, in issues related to logistics, issues related to food assistance, we work with the World Food Program. We also work with the Pan American Health Organization, or PAHO. We work with UNICEF. So, you know, our teams are there to assess, coordinate with the host country, look for gaps and needs. Clearly, 2020 was not only an incredibly active season, you know, my years was one of the more active, well, the most active I've ever seen, but also we had COVID. And so I was on the ground, I had staff on the ground, but there was no vaccine at that point. So we obviously had to, for the first time, look at which staff needed to be on the ground with us and which staff could help us virtually. So that was, again, we had a lot of plans in place for that because we were responding in four different countries at the same time, just for, again, just for the storms. You know, my office right now is responding in eight different countries. We're working the Venezuela regional crisis. Someone mentioned earlier the situation, the volcano situation in St. Vincent. So we have about a $4 or $5 million response going there right now, and obviously very concerned of that situation with ash and everything and with the rains coming. So again, you know, how we work is the countries will make a request to our U.S. ambassador, and then we will deploy. I over the years, I have a local consultant in every country who works with the first responders, if you will, on capacity building. So even before, like right now, our local consultants, you know, who live, I'll give a couple of examples. So we have a full-time person in Guatemala, for example, who on a regular basis is doing capacity building with CONRED, with the Red Cross, with firefighters. And then obviously, if there's a need for response, that individual, again, has all the contacts locally on the ground. We have a, you know, it was a challenge last year with COVID. It still is now. A lot of my staff based here at the U.S. Embassy in Costa Rica, we are vaccinated. But not all my local staff are. So again, I'm trying to get as many of them vaccinated before this hurricane season 2021. I have over 400 locally, what I call surge staff, throughout the region. I think about 200 of them are in countries where hurricanes or storms can hit. And again, this is just to have local folks who have gone through the AID Training Technical Assistance Program, who are already, you know, they live in the communities. They obviously speak Spanish, or, you know, and have the relationships that if we need to fly in and respond. One of the other things, again, as the lead federal coordinator, my job is to coordinate if there's other elements within the U.S. government that we can tap into to help us in an emergency. Last year, obviously, the heroic work of our colleagues from the Department of Defense. I worked very closely with Admiral Fowler and his team at Southern Command. You know, there's the air base in Sotocano, Honduras. We have a staff that will pre-deploy there before, you know, during hurricane season to coordinate our efforts if USAID needs to make a request for DOD support. We can tap into any federal agency depending on the expertise they bring. And as I mentioned earlier, most of our response activities, again, are related. It depends. It could be food assistance. It could be nutrition related, shelter issues, water, sanitation, hygiene issues, health related issues. Obviously, again, with the UN, we work closely with the World Food Program. For example, right now in the St. Vincent response, the World Food Program is helping us both with food assistance and with logistics assistance as well. We can pre-deploy. Normally what we do is when we see a storm coming, we stay in touch with our colleagues at the National Hurricane Center. We can pre-deploy small teams, and then if there's a major impact, we can deploy a larger DART. 5 years ago with Hurricane Matthew in Haiti, we had a 65-person DART team. Obviously, with the pandemic, like I said, most of my staff right now who would deploy are fully vaccinated. But some of our local staff, I'm still trying to get them vaccinated if we were to need their support. One of the things, just to highlight very quickly again, the hub for us in the entire region is based here in Costa Rica. I have try and be as low maintenance for the embassy. So I have my own communication officers. I have my own information officers. We have cash in a safe if we have to fly in, like we've done before in St. Martin and Dominica several years ago, where we'll bring cash in case banks are not open or ATMs are not working and we needed to rent cars and so forth. We do have an office in Haiti, again, where we have food and non-food personnel. Haiti's the one country where we have supplies already pre-positioned. And I also have staff in Guatemala. Clearly, we're also responding to the Northern Triangle emergency in El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala. So we have a lot of emergency awards already going on. So if those, if Honduras and Guatemala were impacted again, we already have staff on the ground. We already have established partners on the ground. So I think with that, you know, again, one of the things that has changed in the past year, for those who, again, remember OFDA, we have now merged with USAID OFDA and USAID Food for Peace. So that's why we are now BHA, the Bureau for Humanitarian Assistance, which makes us stronger. So we can respond. In the past, OFDA did not, you know, respond directly to food assistance type issues. That was more our colleagues from Food for Peace. But now we're one team. I have experts in food security. I have experts in agriculture. I have experts in any technical capability that are part of the team, again, that I manage here out of Costa Rica. And I do want to just reiterate, like I said, my job is to look at and coordinate whatever the U.S. government may do. Obviously, we're, you know, the government of any particular country is responsible for managing the emergency. If there are gaps or needs and they make a request, and we don't have that capability within AID, that's where I can tap into, you know, we have agreements and relationships with NOAA, USGS, Forest Service, USGS, for example, right now in the Caribbean, in St. Vincent, they have a group of scientists, the Volcanic Disaster Assistance Program, who have been providing technical assistance and equipment to the government for the volcano that erupted last month. So I think with that, I'll stop again. We did have people deployed last year. I'm also concerned that there are many communities, especially in Guatemala and El Salvador, still recovering from last year. We are still assessing under the response, what we call the Northern Triangle Emergency, looking at vulnerable communities, vulnerable families, and we're looking at, again, protection issues, water, sanitation, hygiene issues, certainly food assistance right now. We're trying to provide a lot of that. And again, we're also in the process of preparing and communicating to all our embassies. We'll be doing emergency action briefs to all of them. Each ambassador or chief of mission has a focal point for emergencies called a mission disaster relief officer. Those are folks within the embassy, and that's who we coordinate as a storm would be approaching. And again, you know, it would be a combination if a major storm and the embassy wanted us to fly in. We would use the folks we already have on the ground, our local capacity of staff. We would activate them and then bring in the appropriate personnel, again, either from San Jose or if there were technical people I needed from Washington, I would do that. And again, for us, we're trying to get as many of our staff fully vaccinated before we go in. I'm actually flying to El Salvador on Wednesday, and then I'll be going to Honduras and Guatemala, again, as part of my work with the Northern Triangle Emergency. But again, part of it will also be doing hurricane season preparedness. I think with that, I'll stop again. I've been here for 20 years. I do want to reiterate, I work for AID, but I don't do the development side. My role is humanitarian assistance. A lot of what my office does is before an emergency, right? It's the capacity building. It's working on incident command systems, urban search and rescue, how to evaluate damage and needs analysis. And then obviously, if a country makes a request, then we're prepared to respond, again, coordinating with the government, looking at what the gaps and needs are, and then using the tools we have in the U.S. government toolkit to work as quickly and effectively as we can. So I think I'll stop there. And I do want to repeat this, though. Last year was an incredibly busy year. Some years I see a lot of storms hit the United States. Obviously, other years I see them hit, they don't hit the United States, they hit more countries that I cover. My responsibility is outside the United States. So I focus obviously on the Caribbean. We don't cover Puerto Rico, obviously, that's FEMA, but also Central America and Mexico. And, some countries have more capacity than others, but we're prepared always if a country makes a request, there's a gap for need because they've been hit hard, like what happened last year, especially in Guatemala and Honduras, to move quickly, move appropriately, and get resources into our partners' hands to help those most vulnerable. I think I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you for that. So there's one question here, and then I'm going to bring back all of the Roger and Ken and Dan as well to help me here with questions as we wrap up the hour. So, Tim, does USAID work with the Red Cross in impacted countries?
Absolutely. Yeah. So two things on that. Clearly, we work with the local Red Cross, the local chapters. Oftentimes, in the St. Vincent situation, the initial relief assistance, what we call it, that the U.S. ambassador can tap into us quickly, and that's resources we can get to them within 24 hours of them asking. Usually, especially in the Caribbean, we normally go through the Red Cross. There are not a lot of non-government organizations in the Caribbean, so the Red Cross is our main partner. We also clearly work with the International Federation of the Red Cross and also the American Red Cross. But I would say, yes, the Red Cross is one of our main partners. One other partner in the Caribbean, especially for the small island states, is the World Food Program. So the World Food Program, they have an office in Bridgetown, Barbados, and we have provided them with resources now so they can work on capacity building for logistics for the countries in the Caribbean. And as I mentioned earlier, because we have that agreement already in place, they're already responding in St. Vincent between food and logistical support. Because, when we saw with Dorian, the need that the Bahamas had, there were so many different needs. But one need, because, the two islands were impacted, and plus everybody went to Nassau. So the one major issue they had early on was logistics to get support out to the two islands. That had been impacted from the storm. Thank you.
Shirley, I saw one other question that looked like it was a really good one for Tim, and that is, and it's probably a hard question to answer, Tim, because there's been multiple disasters ongoing, but it says, what are the remaining needs for recovery within the region?
Yeah, so right now, and I think it's a great question, and clearly, from last year's storms, between COVID and last year's storms, especially in Central America, and again, primarily Honduras and Guatemala, the number one need right now is food assistance. But we're also looking at other issues, as I mentioned earlier, issues related to agriculture with the negative impacts we saw in there. Early recovery, just helping people get back on their feet. Health-related issues. So those are protection-related issues. I mean, there's been very difficult, with loss of job, loss of income, increased violence for a lot of the countries, and especially Guatemala and Honduras. So we stood up a response team for the storms, and then with the ongoing needs of COVID and still recovering from the storms, we have now stood up a team that is just focusing on Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. And the number one assessed need at this point is food assistance. And that's what we're working on with the three countries. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Shirley, I did see another question I thought was really good here. I might throw it to Ken and maybe any other panelists that want to take that is, someone's, Gene said, you know, one takeaway that they got from all the presentations was just how much the words and messaging means things. And just trying to ask, you know, how do we coordinate? How do we do that messaging? You know, how do we do those key messages, Ken? And maybe you can explain that a little bit. And I know it's, you know, it's coordinated pretty well, at least within the Weather Service, between our local offices and us at the Hurricane Center.
Yeah, a lot of coordination. I mean, Roger, you can attest to this. I mean, just the collaboration calls, the conference calls, but it's not just that. The things that nobody does see. Hey, Roger. Hey, Andy. How's it going? I mean, there's a lot of stuff that goes on besides those formal coordination things that we tag up on. I mean, we're all on the same page and we talk about some words that we can use. The key messages. Is it fair to say, Dan, that we agonize over every word? I think in those key messages, we send them around to multiple people. We look at every word and make sure the meaning doesn't get misconstrued. I think that's a lot of it. But the other part is, you know, the weather forecast offices, Weather Service in general, us at the Hurricane Center. I mean, we're using social media. We're all on one page, and we're getting that wording out there. And you'll see words about the greatest threat is this, and multiple threats. Be ready for this. And I think, you know, I've really seen over the last, what do you all think? I don't know, the last 4 or 5 years, that message is getting much better coordinated. And I think we really are saying the same thing. And I think, you know, one last comment on it is, you know, despite COVID, despite the record season, I feel we come out of it stronger than we've ever been, where we're using video collaboration like this today, where we're sharing forecasts and thoughts and models, and we've never been able to do that before. We've never been able to share a screen like we did last season, and we can hear the comments from Roger and the team, or like, you know, in New Orleans or Houston, all the other offices. That's huge. We've never been able to do that before. So I think we're really on one page, and I think the media interviews and all of us talking, I've never seen the whole enterprise on the same page like I have over the last, you know, 3, 4, 5 years.
Thank you for that. We are 2 minutes away. Roger, any last thoughts or any questions? Dan, do you see one more that we can squeeze in? And I have one final thing to say.
I was going to throw one to Ken if he's got it, you know, if we have the time, just to, you know, ask. We often get questions about what we do during the off season, and I know it's been a busy one for us here at the Hurricane Center. I don't know if you want to touch a little bit on, so, you know, what's you mentioned some of the new stuff, but we do have some updates to the slosh modeling coming up for this season. And also, Ken, you know, just talking about how much we do for the decision support services for like the Coast Guard year round with folks in our Marine branch as well. I don't know if you want to make any comments on that, Ken.
Well, first, if you're Roger or the forecast offices, they're not just dealing with the hurricanes. They've got tornadoes like yesterday. So, you know, there's tornadoes up in the portions of the Southeast. They're dealing with winter weather. They're dealing with flooding. So for a weather forecast office, it's definitely year round. You know, for us, we have the tropical analysis forecast branch. They're dealing with the marine forecast. We got a huge area over the Atlantic and the Pacific. They issue the forecasts and look for places that are gonna have to look at warnings when it comes to the winds and seas. But not only that, they're on standby for the open waters, kind of like what the WFOs do in the coastal waters within 60 miles and around the Gulf. Issue the spot forecast. So if there's an incident where there's a search and rescue, they can, you know, the Coast Guard can request a specific forecast for one spot to really keep them safe during that search and rescue operation. So we're doing that 365, 24/7 here at the Hurricane Center. So it's still busy, even though there's no hurricane. There's a whole group of folks always watching the waters. But for Roger, I don't know if you want to add to that, but y'all busy year round. I worked in Louisiana 15 years of my career, and I don't think it ever ended working at the New Orleans office. There was always something going on.
Yeah, it's been there hasn't been a break for us locally. We got impacted by the winter weather as well. And we've already had multiple tornadoes, and unfortunately people have died in the tornadoes this year as well. So You're always on your toes in the weather in Louisiana.
Thank you for that. And all the best to you. Stay safe out there. Our viewers and our panelists, thank you. We are at the top of the hour. We couldn't get to all the questions. We will review them and then see if we can answer them afterwards. The recording, this webinar has been recorded and will be available at the website I posted on the chat there, and also at the through NHC's social media channels. We will post a link for that. So again, thank you. Stay tuned. Next Monday, join us again. We're going to do another seminar, and this time it'll be in Espanol. It'll be about Hurricane Maria, 4 years after Puerto Rico got hit by Hurricane Maria. How are they recovering? How are things going for the island of Puerto Rico? So stay tuned for that. Thank you again. Thank you to our presenters, and have a good day.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks, Shirley.